Mustafa contacted me directly for Halloween 6, and the most important thing to him was to make the mask what everybody thinks it should be. Apparently, he was not a big fan of the last mask from Part 5, and you know, he showed me the poster of the Halloween movies. This is what it has to look like.
The mask was sculpted by Chris Robbins, who is a really talented makeup artist. I think his only reference was a poster from Halloween 4.
I would come in from time to time and punch the clay a little bit myself, but it was mostly Chris who had sculpted it, and he did a great job.
Yeah, John's got a lot of insight as to what he wants it to look like. Even when he gives you the ability to go off on your own and be creative, he always comes around and likes to put his influence on it.
Most of the stuff I did was just detail and you know, making sure the proportion was the correct thing. Because I really went for the poster. I really went for what everybody perceived as the Michael Myers mask.
Some of the fabrication later on was done by John Foster and myself, and we did the hair and the paint.
It wasn't just clown white anymore. It was washes of burnt umber and sienna in just the right way, so that the shadow was permanently indelified into the mask, so it would look like Michael no matter what direction or how, you know, what kind of blue gels you put on it. It was Michael. And you know, even if you put the old William Shatner mask on George Wilbur, it would not look the same, because George is a huge guy, and the guys inside the original Halloween mask were somewhat slight. So the task was to basically sculpt on George Wilbur's life mask. George is a great guy. He's funny, and he's a very kind and just guy. And to think this is a guy that plays Michael Myers, you know, he was a big teddy bear. And he was a pleasure to work with all the time.
Mustafa Akkad wanted me to come back. Well, I knew the character after doing 4, what Mr. Akkad wanted. He wanted a certain look, so I felt, and my contribution to 6 was to maintain that character. I know there was conflict on the set. It wasn't like when we did 4, there was nothing like it was happening on 6. Halloween 4 was smooth. Everybody worked good together. But there was a lot of distractions on Halloween 6.
We didn't know anything about any additional photography. We thought the film was done and in the can. When we did the LA photography, somebody thought that maybe George was too big, too bulky. As a result, Michael Lerner, who was much thinner, and somebody recommended him, probably his dad, Fred Lerner, who was a stuntman on the film, actually did all the Michael stuff in the additional photography in LA.
It was the director's preference that I'd be replaced at that time. And so that's what it is. That's showbiz, you know, that happens all the time. People come and go on shows.
As far as I know, George did everything that he was told to do exactly the way he was told to do it. I know that when we got to doing the additional photography, he was not around, which was, I think, too bad, you know, because I think there would have been a nice consistency to have him there. The guy that they had was a little smaller.
They're both great guys. You know, George actually still was there doing stunts, so there's a scene where George is actually killed by Michael Lerner as Shape in the hospital.
The director requested me, so I went back. No animosity, just always friends. I got back with a smile, and I left with a smile.
The movie was a little confused in terms of tone. Somewhere between the producer and the director, I think there was conflict. I know that I was asked to meet Harvey Weinstein with the producer, and we had discussed the specific makeup effects and the visceral quality that Harvey wanted. And I have to say, we were exactly on the same page. Let's go for broke, let's go nuts, let's make it crazy, weird. And I walked out of that meeting feeling pretty well. But then subsequently on the elevator ride down, the producer basically turns to me and says, we're not doing any of that crap.
I think originally they were gonna do a lot more in Utah. And I don't know if it was just, they decided to cut some of it. But then when they had a screening and decided that they needed a little more blood and guts, you know.
And that's why I was brought back to go ahead and start inventing things. But a whole bunch of makeup effects artists were brought back to come in and do stuff. The big thing that I did was the asshole father. You got to see his head blow up. So that was a lot of fun.
The Bradford English electrocution, which is kind of my favorite thing that I did on the film. You know, I thought that turned out well.
It didn't make any sense at all, but it was over the top and crazy. And we got to show his face puff and erupt like a Hoffy hot dog, and then Ballpark Frank's plumped, and then he exploded. It was lots of fun.
Hey, what are you doing to my truck? What the hell are you doing to my truck?
The truck driver, I broke his neck.
And you see a spine come out. We had one gag, I believe, where this sort of shock jock radio announcer got his just come up, and so we did a full body cast of the guy, and you know, ultimately it could have been a stuntman the way it was shot. It just, you know, it was rushed and it didn't work, but we did create a wonderful makeup effect that hardly anybody got to see. And for me, these kinds of movies are all about the surprise, the irony, and the visual quality of it. And while it was beautifully photographed and you know, very well acted, I think the director did a really good job given the limitations. But all in all, I think the movie was compromised from the beginning. And I think that the confusion of kind of knowing which direction they wanted to go with the film is why there are so many cuts of the film.
I did. I saw the producer's cut. And in a way, it was definitely closer to Daniel's original script, but it was still lacking some things from his original script. Was amazing. It was a great script.
I think Daniel Farren's screenplay had a unique twist. It did something that I'm usually at odds with. But it did it, I think, in a very masterful way. I think Dan Farrens is a great writer, and he had a great take on how to turn Halloween into something and move it into sort of a different direction. The whole thing with the runes and the ancient brotherhood who's keeping Michael alive to do their dirt, that was kind of fun.
We thought we were really going to be working on like an amazing sequel.
Now with Michael and telling basically his origin, when you start to do that, you begin to sympathize with the character and you're not as afraid. Dan Farrens did a great job in controlling it and not getting it blatantly in your face, just sort of letting you follow the clues and allowing the story to unfold. And I think that in and of itself made it a little bit more interesting and not just another Halloween film. And that's what really drew me to the project.
I think we made a good movie, but I think if they would have stuck to his original script, and we would have had a great movie. He did some rewrites and he did what he had to do to make it work, and I think he did a great job.
Irregardless of, you know, what cut we look at, Halloween is an enduring classic. Any film that goes to part six is a classic.
I think time has been good to the film. I think when you stack it up with the other sequels, I think it holds up. To work on a Halloween sequel was like, really, it was a thrill for me. And the fact that I got to play Michael in a couple scenes, and I got to play Michael on MTV to promote the film, Planet Hollywood. I'll never forget that. It was really a great experience.
No movie is perfect, and every movie has its own problems. I think had Joe and Dan been allowed just to do their vision, I think it would have been great.